And there we go. Welcome to peoplesinternetradio.com. I'm coming through there. My sound is coming through there. You should be able to see me here. Excellent. Typical. I just tried to say, okay, ready to launch broadcast. And computer said no. Ooh, it's a bit silly tonight. Welcome to peoplesinternetradio.com. A great show for you tonight. I have the one and only Freeman Jack on tonight. Freeman Jack used to broadcast on People's Internet Radio back in the TNS and MSI radio days. And I'm not going to big him up too much. But really, we should. We really should. He's a little nervous to think about coming back on with us again tonight. He hasn't been on the radio in quite some time. But I'm going to tweak that a little here. He really should be bigged up because I'm not going to talk about Freeman Jack in the sense of his knowledge and his understanding, because I don't think that would be fair, even to him. What I think should be mentioned, though, is his dedication to his subject. When Freeman Jack is dedicated to something, he becomes the very definition. He epitomizes the word. And I'm really looking forward to having him on. So he's in the background there. Somebody was trying to ring me a second ago. I don't know who you were, but I was about to go live, so that's never a good time to ring me when I'm just about to go live. Okay, folks, can you hear me there okay? Let me know in the chat box if you can hear me loud and clear, and if you can see me on the little telly screen. Actually, where's the... Yeah. The player should be above me, and the screen should be below the radio player. Do let me know if you can hear me okay, though. Okay, that clearly needs another little tweak. How's that now? I'm going to bring in our guest now, and we're going to be talking about the electric universe theory, the idea of electrobiology, the electric universe theory meets, it's Freeman Jack, he's right there now with me, there we go, I see him there now, he's ready to come on, where it meets the digital virtual holographic universe theory. I just wanted to make sure I got that right. So I'm going to pull in Freeman Jack now. I'll say thank you very much to Billy, but you stay in the call, Billy. You can just listen in there. There's no problem at all. I'm adding Jack into the call now. Right, let's go for it, Jack.
Give it a title first, shall we?
Well, this is it. So where should we begin? I mean, I gave it a sort of a title.
The title that I gave for you to give out was Electric Universe Theory meets Electrobiology Theory and on to its logical conclusion within the larger construct of the digital virtual holographic reality theory.
Right.
Really, I suppose we need to kind of break this down. I don't know if you saw the message that I posted you from my fan.
No, because I was on the road.
My singular fan, honestly, is my one fan. He's been loyal. He's been devoted. He's been with me for 5 years. He's got every single damn thing that I've ever recorded on record. He's basically joined me in all of my research groups.
Okay.
And has remained silent about his lack of understanding of the basics of electricity.
Okay.
So to my mind, the first thing that we need to cover really is just simply the fundamentals of electricity.
Okay, well, that makes sense to me. However, before we go there, just prior to that, maybe we should just kind of give an overall. I'd just like to maybe give an overall on what this is. Essentially, folks, there is a model of the universe and its existence and how it came into existence out there so essentially there's the Big Bang theory that's purportedly being sold, as it were, and this is what everybody's been educated to accept now. And there's a gravitational model, of course, that really has been used by physicists all over the world to drive, although they're really mathematicians / physicists. They're not really physicists, in my opinion, the way they operate. But basically, they're saying the gravitational force essentially is what's doing it all, inverted commas, as in how galactic formation and all of that. Of course, then they realised, well, oops, that's not actually enough. We don't have enough matter in the universe. It seems to hold everything together in the way it is. So effectively, when they realized 97% roughly of what they needed to be there didn't seem to be there, apparently they discovered it was all to do with dark matter and dark energy. Whereas if you were to do any other type of investigation, even a legal investigation, for example, and you discovered 97% of what you're looking for is not there, you don't get to come into a courtroom, for example, to say, "Oh, it's dark evidence and it's." Sorry, I can hear you laughing, Jack. Right, but you know, you just wouldn't get away with that, folks. Right?
Anybody that thinks that a black hole actually exists just needs to go and look at Stephen Carruthers' work.
Oh, Stephen Carruthers is brilliant.
Debunking it. Right. I mean, the asymptotic curve with a radius of R0. And an escape velocity of light speed is just so ludicrous as to how they've managed to fool the general scientific community to going along with this as a general theory is just ridiculous.
So we're going to have to be careful here, Jack, because I don't want to initially start off with blasting people with stuff, but essentially...
Sorry.
Right, yeah, so ease back a tad. What we were talking about there was...
Can we just cover basic electrical theory first, just simply for the listeners who have absolutely no understanding of what an amp is, what a watt is, what a volt is?
Not just yet. I'll tell you why. Okay, settle down for a second, settle down. He's excited. Welcome back to People's Internet Radio, Jack, by the way. So what I'm trying to say is there is a model that's put out there. The reason I want to be careful here is I want everybody to understand. There is a model that's out there. It's been taught in all the textbooks and it's been discussed ad infinitum in all the universities.
And billions of, taxpayers.
It's everywhere. It's everywhere.
Spent pursuing it as almost an assumed.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Now, what we're basically going to talk about tonight is not some crazy wild theory, even though you may actually think of it in those terms until you begin to investigate this. I think it's important to point out that this is not so much a paradigm shift, Jack, as it's literally wiped the slate clean, except for the existing structure in place at present. They, of course, have lots and lots of material about electricity, which we found, and almost everybody in the electric universe world, I suppose, has found to hold true pretty much in all sets of circumstances. And yet, the existing structure, they refuse, as it were, they absolutely refuse to apply any of that to the models that they have based on gravitational collapse for matter, etc., and gravitational effects of matter.
And to some degree, that's becoming a little farcical because of the number of unexpected events that are happening with their latest sort of explorer missions and their comet relays and stuff, just prove electric universe theory every single time and just totally unexplained to
them. So I think what we need to explain to people is that what's explained to be gravity, or the strength, if you will, of the gravitational force. To me, I consider it's a gravitational effect. You can call what you see as a physical object. You pick something up, you let it go. Sure, we'll use gravity to describe the effect. Newtonian maths works fine for launching satellites and space shuttles and all of that stuff. In fact, quantum mathematics will not work for all of that, right? But, so that's fine, and you can call it gravity. Essentially, what we're saying is, though, it's an effect, but it's an effect of something. And the idea that when they looked out into the universe and they couldn't find enough stuff, they were stunned. Yet, we can see in the universe, there's patterns and designs that go from the micro to the macro and back to the micro again. And that, of course...
And started making it up as they went along, rather than basing it on actual observable data. And the electric universe theory is based entirely on observable known data.
Yes, absolutely. So I just really wanted to make that clear to everybody that this is it's probably going to be new to a lot of people. Stick with it. I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to be your mirror. I'm going to try to keep my lingo... clean. I'm going to keep my lingo in layman's terms as much as possible tonight, okay? So, for example, I'm not going to talk about the Schwarzschild radius being what you were referring to for Stephen Crothers. Right.
Then.
Okay. So we're not going to go in with all that. And we're not going to go... We'll explain what purportedly what a radius... Think of a circle, folks, with a with a radius of zero or a negative radius. We can't even imagine it. It's an impossibility. So that's what Jack was talking about there. They use these things in their mathematics, right? So it's bizarre. A circle to exist, even a theoretical circle, must have a radius of x. You can't have a radius of minus x or of x equaling zero. It's not a circle then. So, okay, Jack, I'm going to move to you now because you're bursting. Go.
Right, okay. Well, let's start out with the fundamentals first. In order to visualize electricity, right. Now, this is obviously only a model. This isn't an actual description of how electricity works. But in order to be able to understand the units of electricity, a domestic water system is probably your easiest analogy. So in your domestic water system, when you turn the tap, water comes out. Well, if we consider the water to be coming, that's coming out to be the equivalent of the electricity flowing through a wire, is the voltage. That's the electrical pressure in the wire. The pressure that the water is coming out into the tap at is the voltage. So that's the electrical pressure. The size of the pipe will be the wattage. So the power, the current, and the sort of slipperiness of the pipe would be the resistance. So basically, when electricity flows through a wire, if you have a fatter wire, you can get more electricity through theoretically. But in order to get more electricity through, you have to provide a bigger pressure and a greater current, a greater flow, in order to be able to achieve the greater transport. So I hope that explains the sort of basics of electricity in terms of volts, amps, and watts.
Yeah, so any electricians listening, of course, will remember V over I equals R.
Yes, of course.
Okay. Now,
which
so
is volts equals amperage over resistance.
Yeah. Now, what I'm going to say is for the average Joe, I should be on screen now. There we go. So the average Joe, so you can think of the idea is simple. So what we call electricity, generally in the world, we think of it as it needs to flow through a cable. However, we also know we see a lightning in the skies and we know, well, it can clearly flow.
I was about to touch on the field of plasma next.
Okay, but hang on. Yeah, but right. I won't interrupt you in the middle of an explanation if you don't interrupt me. Okay. So
agreed.
People understand, as I said, I'm doing Joe Soap, remember? So we have electricity runs through a wire. We can also see lightning in the sky. We can see it hits the earth. So clearly it can flow through a gas. And then if you buy one of those little plasma balls as a Christmas present for someone, you know those little etheric balls with these blue streams coming through them and a purple glow in the center. That's another form of electricity we know as a glow mode plasma. You'll also see it in neon signs in your local chip shop or the American diner style. That's a glowing plasma of a gas, okay? So essentially that's the way it works. And that's the way that would be a good understanding for people. Also, we know about static electricity when you run around with nylon shoes on a nylon carpet, for example, and you touch your finger off a door handle, you'll actually see a little spark of electricity, and people usually jump. Or sometimes when you're filling your car, you have to be very careful with this. You should always touch your car before you take the nozzle from the filling station and fill your car. You should always ground yourself off the car first. So to most people, I think that's what they consider electricity. Now, what modern-day scientists and physicists are having a real tough time accepting is that electricity and electric currents, and even though they do talk about magnetic fields in space, they find it almost impossible. Would you say that's a good understanding? They find it almost impossible to accept.
Well, the description of space as an absolute vacuum precludes the transport of electricity. Electricity on its own will not travel through a vacuum, and that's
so
really where most of the physicists are just blanking this completely.
Correct. Okay. So
it doesn't fit with their model of space.
Right.
Therefore, it doesn't exist.
Yes. Even though one of the reasons I was talking about gravity earlier was that the force, the gravitational force, in comparison to the electromagnetic force, It's what's the exact figure, Jack, of its the difference?
It's a factorial of 35 times weaker, so it's
practically non-existent.
It's a point, yeah. And 35 noughts, and then a one,
yeah,
of the equivalent value in electricity.
Yeah,
it's a very weak force, is gravity, if it's, yeah, it exists at all.
Okay, so look, I think now that we have the basics out, I think they're the basics. That's a good solid base.
Well, like I say, I think in that you actually touched on the perfect illustration of the next thing that really needs to be understood in order to grasp both electric universe theory and electrobiology, mm-hmm. and that's the coronal discharge. Now, we're all familiar with the old CRT-type television screens and computer monitors, the ones that used to have the long backs on them and that used to make your eyes really tired.
Mm-hmm.
That is a corona discharge device. It's firing electricity out of a gun and, funnily enough, through a vacuum and at a screen. And so we see the coronal discharge on a screen. Normally, coronal discharge, unless it's at an incredibly high current, we don't see.
So essentially,
the coronal discharge that we're all familiar with, as you also mentioned, was lightning. But lightning is a really extraordinary, extreme end of coronal discharge.
Yes.
That's something called glow mode plasma.
Okay, so again,
if you pass enough current through this coronal discharge, eventually it will create its own circuit where one didn't exist, and that's what we call lightning.
So, okay, so for Joe Soap again, Jack is talking about there is the old-style television that we call a cathode ray tube. You have an electron gun at the back, which you have an anode and a cathode. Fires through the vacuum. There's an electromagnet around it. It hits the screen, and then that's why we get this. And it scans across the screen. That's why there was all these scan lines on your TV screen. So, again, it's different. Even though we see this in our everyday life, we're trying to just get you to recognize what it is we're talking about.
Ordinarily, it's invisible because until it goes into glow mode, it's not giving off any photons.
There you go. So do you want to start, Jack, with the micro or the macro for an explanation?
I would actually love for you to go electric universe first, because out of the two of us, I feel that it's a subject that you've probably done the more study on, while I've been devoting my attention to the electrobiology, which stems from that. Just to point out that I moved into electrobiology from coming across the electric universe theory, but for me, I kind of localized that into my own personal private researches because I was in the process of commercial growing and wanted to see if there was some way that this new information could be sort of worked in as a commercial sort of process. Mm-hmm. And I've had great success with that. But in order to understand where I came from with the electrobiology, I feel that the electric universe is probably the predominant theory.
Well, what I'm going to suggest is that, and I'll put the link up in a while, anybody who wants to begin to understand where this comes from, I'm going to give you a link to the Thunderbolts Project on YouTube.
And probably the more interesting one to more listeners.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, perhaps if I explain what I think of as the electric universe theory, and you can probably elaborate on that more successfully.
So a quick overview of the electric universe idea is essentially that the greatest force of nature it's more... A better way of thinking about it is a structure. In my mind, to think of it as a structure of incredible power and capable of the most infinitely subtle finery and gentleness combined. And the structure relates to all of the mathematics we've seen to date, all the mathematics essentially we've created. It relates to motions of planets, effects of the bodies that we see on the planets, everything from their discharge, their atmospheres, their magnetic fields, even their location away from their parent star, that distance, how it's maintained.
The illumination of suns and stars.
Exactly. For example, the surface of the sun is only about 6,000 degrees, where the corona, Jack's favorite part, is in the millions.
Plasma.
Right. So it's in the millions of degrees. Now, the explanation that, for example, stars are fusion reactors doesn't make any sense. It doesn't possibly. I knew Jack was going to start laughing there. It doesn't. It can't possibly. So, for example, you can't have something colder on the inside and hotter on the outside and say, "Oh yeah, that's it's the super hot core that's producing all that heat."
Completely ridiculous, exotic physics to explain it.
Yeah, you know, you need to go into, and this is what happened to physics.
But you have to be a mathematician to be able to understand.
Yeah, it turned into a nonsense. So what I'm going to say is, no, I think it's time to hand it over to you in the sense of let's hear your.
Okay, all right. So as a fundamentals of electric universe, the primary, I think, really the primary consideration has to be the reconsideration of the modelling of gravity as this unknown force that seems to act everywhere equally. Attractively, and this is the reason why they've had to invent all these ridiculous black holes and dark matters and dark energies. And essentially the model that the electric universe, not all of the electric universe, I mean the electric universe group, the Thunderbolts of the Gods project, I assume now must be up to hundreds of academics.
Yes.
Who are on board and fully engaged in the academic study of this subject. So as Vin says, this is not fringe science by any means.
Absolutely. These are
just people that have simply realised that the SI model is broken and it needs reconsidering. And the primary reconsideration involved in order to get an electric universe theory is to do away with this mystery of gravity. And the theoreticians of the electric universe theory have based their ideas upon an asymmetry on the atomic level. So basically, if the planet has a broadly positive charge, the atmosphere is negatively charged, the Earth is positively charged, this is where we get the lightning from. Huge voltages involved, constantly there all the time, it just under certain circumstances the two connect. But if we consider that the planet underneath us is positively charged, and that positive charge pulls on the orbits of the electrons of every single atom in our body and makes them spin eccentrically. So instead of spinning in a neat, nice neat circle around their nucleus, they're now spinning towards that positive charge. And what this does is it actually creates a dipole. So every single atom in your body, instead of being a neutrally charged atom, if it's a nuclearly charged atom, now becomes an electrical dipole with a negative charge at the bottom being attracted to all the positive charges below you.
Okay, sorry folks, we have our own glitch in the matrix, it seems. I'm trying to get Jack back there. We're not getting him. As you can tell, he's very excited to be on talking about the electric universe tonight and electrobiology. So what I'll try to do is I'm going to try and give you, just until he comes back, I'm going to try and just simplify it a little bit. Essentially what we're trying to say here is that it would seem that, now this, as we say, this is not a conspiracy theory. There are, at this stage, I think, thousands of scientists getting on board and delighted to be able to say, you know what, this seems to be something that works. This seems to be not just correct, but absolutely correct, accurate, logical, reasonable, and why should you care? This is why. Why should you care? Across the internet, I've noticed there are, I'm going to call them flat earthers, for want of a better term, and I believe that the flat earth theory has been put out there to cause confusion, particularly to keep, and specifically to keep people away from the electric universe theory. And I think it's an attempt to scupper some of their good work. I reject the idea of a flat earth. I think logic and reason is all we need to do so. I've done so many a time. I've had discussions with people who believed the earth was flat, and they've yet to have a conversation with me without using logical fallacies of some form or another. And when I point them out to them, they got very upset with me, and they just resorted to insults, etc. And you see, I don't bother conversing in those. I am perfectly capable of slinging insults, but it's childlike, and it just doesn't make any sense. Okay, test, I'm back. Now I'm going to call Jack in again. Are you there, Jack? Okay, so what I was explaining to people there, Jack, was I was saying that my feeling was that all, a lot of this flat earth crap that was put out there was specifically put out there, I think, to steer people away from investigating the electric universe model. It didn't, in my opinion, but I think that, that's what it was attempting to do, you know, because I noticed flat earthers, for example, were saying things like gravity's not real, it's to do with density, and up is up and down is down, and they were saying things like this. And you see, the electric universe model, it's a different model. Gravity is still there, as it were, in the electric universe model, but there's a better description for it, essentially. And it operates more. Essentially, what we're saying here, folks, is that electrobiology, electric effects in what we call, and on what we call matter, are intimately connected. Intimately connected. And in fact, with the electric model, you can use it and it works and it functions on all levels. So, for example, it works from clusters of galaxies, to solar systems, to individual bodies in the solar system, to the bodies on around those bodies, moons, to the bodies on those planets and moons, like us, for example, the creatures, all the creatures and the plants and the insects. And then when you get down to the structure, the very structure of the atoms, chemical compounds, why they're compounds, why they bond to each other, and the internal structure thereof, literally from micro to macro and back again. And to where else, who knows? But if we have, I mean, would you call this a unifying theory, Jack? How would you describe it?
I think that in certain senses it unifies, it certainly unifies cosmology.
Right.
As another factor to consider as well is the assumption that redshift somehow can be interpreted as the receding speed of a distant sun, which is basically the entire current model of the universe is based on something called redshift, which is an observed effect within the spectrum of light that we receive from a distant object, and there are missing gaps in that spectral light according to what elements are being burnt within that distant sun. Mm-hmm. And these gaps are have a known position when they're red on Earth, and when we see these spectral lines as they're received from distant suns, they appear to be shifted to the red end of the spectrum. And this is known as redshift, and it's put down to something called the Doppler effect, which when a motorbike approaches, how it changes pitch when it goes past you. This is the sound waves compressing as they approach you and stretching out as they're going away. Well, they're now the redshift relies on the assumption that this shifting to the red is A, due to a Doppler effect, and B, is down to the recession of the observed object and not to do with the quality or the nature of the light being emitted from it. And so without redshift, essentially, the current cosmological model has to be entirely rewritten. So to some degree, that's not necessarily a unifying theory, but having rejected redshift, we now go back into observed distance, which can only be achieved through something called parallax. So basically, by taking an observation in high summer and taking an observation in high winter, you're either side of the sun, so that gives you a physical change in position of observation. And by comparing the relative positions of stars through those two observations, you can make certain conclusions about the actual distance of those stars. Now, the numbers of stars that have actually been mapped by this measurement are only in the tens of light years away. So really, we only know that the universe is tens of light years across, really, realistically. Everything else is guesswork after that.
Yeah, we in classical physics, I suppose, it's known as they call it the horizon problem. They used to say 27 billion light years in every direction. Essentially, what they were saying was the universe, as far as they could see, was 27, in a bubble of 27 billion light years.
Yeah, I was going to say, because it's actually the observable universe is 13 billion light years.
Yeah.
Under their model. Because of the receding boundary. Let's just clarify that. The reason why the most outlying reach of the universe that theoretically can be observed is because the speed that it's receding away from us at those peripheries is such at such great speeds that it exceeds the speed of light. coming towards us, and so the light will never reach us. So essentially the furthest that we will ever see into the universe in their model, according to redshift, will be 13.5 billion light years.
Yeah. Now, earlier I was talking about why I believe that the flat earth stuff was being put out there, Jack, as if you will, a preemptive.
Sorry, I absolutely missed all of the mention of flat earth. And
I know.
Geez, that's please don't even get me started.
Well, that's why I was repeating it. So just let me finish the repeat, because I don't want to be repeating myself too much. So there's a discussion in the chat. That's what you may not be aware of. So I can see some guys in the chat talking about this. And it's effectively, it's why does it matter? Well, I'll say why it matters. This is why it matters. A, because it matters. We are either in one extreme or the other. We can't be in both. And if anybody is not seeking knowledge, you're effectively spreading something just because you believe it to be so is one thing. Where you can demonstrate it to be so, another. Now, the only way science...
I think as far as why is this important, a really simple answer to that is because it allows us to predict the likely circumstances that we're likely to be presented with and possibly take effective measures to protect ourselves against the most extreme ones. And some of the stuff that's coming out through the electric universe theory, some of it can be pretty damn scary, you know what I mean? Catastrophes in space 101.
Well, I would like to say that, for example, the electric universe model seems to indicate to me that large planetary collisions are actually probably very unlikely.
Almost impossible, but that doesn't necessarily mean that the likes of the flybys that we've suffered under the acquisition of Venus as a comet aren't going to happen again in future, and certainly being able to model the solar system at least,
right,
and it's likely, you know, in interactions with other bodies is, I mean, we have to first of all at least accept that we're part of a binary system. Which just changes everything, you know what I mean? Our sun is not a sun on its own. It's like every other sun in the universe. It's rotating around another sun with a common centre of gravity that's outside of both of their centres of mass.
Right. Well, the point I was going to make is that the flat Earth model that's being presented to everybody essentially is pointing everybody to a very specific form of a religious indoctrination. And therefore, it is the absolute opposite of science. It's they want it to fit a particular model for a particular reason. Whereas honest investigation with the electric universe model, nobody really knows exactly where it's going to lead. That's why it's honest.
I'm sorry, but to be quite honest, I even really have difficulty even discussing this, because I think that anybody that even remotely has been convinced by the flat earth model needs to be going and seeing a psychiatrist or a doctor to get medication.
Well, I don't think that's fair.
In the public domain, I think that's just bloating their egos. I have refused to click on a single flat earth link yet.
Right. Well, I don't think that's fair.
It's a logical fallacy. It's just it's a distraction.
No, well, I don't think that's fair, and I think many decent people I know have been distracted by it, but I don't think it's fair to just dismiss it. That's unscientific as well. So
no, I agree with that. I kind of regretted saying that as soon as I had, but to a degree, just simply to be able to remain unpolluted by it.
Well, what I'd say is,
and largely because of my own personal researches, you know,
which is fine.
As you suggested in your fabulously glowing intro to the show,
right,
when I dedicate myself to a subject, I dedicate myself to that subject.
And yes,
for me,
you do.
The whole flat earth argument would have just been a grand distraction that I could well do without.
Yeah, but at the same time, as I say, so I'm now saying to anybody who has looked at the flat earth stuff and who has, even if you've been convinced, I'm saying if you are an honest, and if you want to be honest with yourself as well, don't you think you deserve the chance to explore the idea that the electric universe model could be an accurate model, and that, you know, you could therefore make your own mind up in that regard, not based upon some religious belief, but based upon the actual evidence and provable, demonstrable evidence. You see, this is why the electric universe, you can model it on a tabletop it, you don't even need major equipment. I'm actually going to produce some of these models. After Michael Steinbecker died, he passed away, and he was doing experiments. He had somebody doing experiments for him, and I was looking at the rig and the setup, and I'm thinking, well, I can do that. So I'm going to do some of these experiments myself. And as I say, it's a way of proving it to yourself. Whereas the flat earth model, nobody has ever come up with any way, for example, that a flat earth could possibly form, nor do they tell me how there the sun
the
can produce
simple motions of the planets. You
well,
have to have planets
no, hang on. Stop. They don't talk about, as far as they're concerned, Jack, the planets are only points of light in the sky, you see? That's what they say.
That happened to
and as I said, well, let me finish this because I've really researched the flat earth. I've looked at all their videos and all their material, and I would be happy to take, I think Eric Dubai is considered their king at the moment. I would be very happy to take Eric Dubai on if he's prepared to, for a logical reason discussion. And I don't believe he will be successful in convincing me we're on a flat body, because they can't explain its formation. Electric universe can. Modern physics can't explain planetary formation. They claim it's the disk of gas collapsing under gravitational influence, and that cannot happen. It's impossible.
That fails on the first hurdle.
Right.
That doesn't even get past. Basically, the initial clumping is electrostatic in that model.
Exactly.
And then there's nothing to jump between the small electrostatic clumps.
Yes.
And anything that could reasonably be considered an orbital body.
Of course. And of course, then once you have an electrostatic clump, you now have essentially produce a bigger field, which will attract more, so forth and so on. So I just wanted to nail home the flat earth stuff from my perspective. I just want to get that off the table. So now that's off the table as far as I'm concerned. So let's continue with EU now, Jack. And I'm keeping video off, folks, for tonight, because I think maybe this software is causing a glitch on this other software here as well. So
like I say, Vin, the numbers in the chat, I would suggest it's probably just bloody server load.
It could be. It could be. So look, here's what I want to say. Why don't we go there? Let's go there. So essentially what modern physics tells us, folks, is that a load of dust, for some reason, just arrived nice and uniformly in a particular location.
Well, first of all, it had to be distributed clumpily to start with, because we're going from a Big Bang model where the entire universe started from one of these R equals zero points in space.
Right.
And somehow exploded to fill all of the volume that we see now, although it was exploding into nothing that can be explained. So we have a point of nothing exploding into nothing, creating somehow an internal volume and structure.
Yes.
And while it does so, it has to do so asymmetrically to such a degree that we have clumps of matter that are able to coalesce into stars and planets.
Yes, and it's this is what I'm talking about. So this idea that you have enough stuff essentially in a place that can somehow, under gravitational collapse, form stars and planets, etc. It never made sense to me. It never felt right to me. It never seemed logical and reasonable to me. So I was always, that's partly why I was such a dedicated, devout researcher of all these topics, Jack, because I always thought, you know, there has to be a logical answer. I mean, but they don't seem to know what it is. Now, as I start researching this, I'm sure, like yourself, you get into all the quantum theory and the string theory and this theory and that theory.
Oh,
and, of course, they all...
so much of my intellectual time and space on all of those subjects.
Right, and all of these theories, and I mean, I'm not going to go into a conspiracy mode here, folks, but what I'm going to say is it's because of the structure of the banking system and the monetary system in universities, etc., and because of their sponsorship deals,
the militarization.
Essentially, they were forced to do this. They won Nobel Prizes for finding particles that didn't exist, or even just saying there might be a particle, you know? It was bizarre. It was bizarre. And, you know, that's why I, for one, do not worry about what everybody was doing at CERN. I'm on record here for saying, you know, when Alex Jones was on screaming, oh, my God, they're going to create a black hole in CERN and it's going to suck the world inside of itself. Do you remember that? And I'm on record, folks, saying we don't have to worry about what they're doing at CERN. They cannot possibly create a black hole, because black holes cannot possibly exist. They can't.
Yeah.
It doesn't make sense.
Oh, but they were going to make a really, really small one. Really.
Yeah, micro black holes. And, and you see, R equals zero, and they thought they were going to make a micro version, a small version of R equals zero. It's bizarre. You know, it's bonkers, bonkers. But yet, hey, if I went in there and I had my doctorate, etc., hey, can I have a research grant to go and research this for 12 years at the cost of 50 billion? Of course you can. Excellent. And the reason, in fairness, the reason it made sense in the business world for them to do that is because along the way, they would make other useful discoveries. You know, all the guys using laser interferometers, for example, they would say, well, you know what, they've been tinkering with these lasers for a couple of years, and they'd say, hey, you know what, for example, I reckon we could read data off a compact disc with this. Well, let's try it. And you got CDs, right? But that's not what they started off researching.
I mean, this is not to be in any way dismissive of the huge actual technological advances that have been capable through the quantum model. But the only thing is that the quantum model is mathematically coherent, but theoretically fundamentally flawed.
Yeah.
So mathematically, you can predict the activity of a circuit through the quantum model, but because there's no theory to underline it, because they can't explain what an atom is or how it works without basically referring to mysterious theories or mathemagics, I call it.
It became mathemagics. That's exactly what it became. And
well, we're talking about the sort of 1920 Copenhagen Agreement, when sort of Einstein and all of the sage minds of the day all got together to basically decide that the quantum model was the one that they were going to pursue. And really, science just has descended into a laughable state since then. And in fact, discoveries have almost ground to a halt. The last major discovery was something like 1970.
Well, one of our one of everybody's favorite researchers, I suppose, and inventors, Tesla, was eventually, after his death, eventually, you know, all the big names in electricity, General Electric, RCA, all of these big players. Essentially, they all stopped research and development in those areas. I mean, you're a fan of Eric Dollard, I know. I like Eric Dollard. I don't necessarily agree with everything he says, but I really like the guy, and I like...
Not necessarily, I wouldn't say a fan.
Well...
He's a fairly deeply unpleasant individual.
I actually quite like him. I think he's quite quirky.
Okay. But then again... His treatment of his... when he fell onto real hard times, basically was destitute recently and was... rescued by a bunch of Tesla fans and given a lab and all sorts. And he's actually on public record as having run off with a load of the money.
Well, you know, again, he does his thing. Let's just say he's eccentric, but he's quirky. But as I say, I like the guy. That's not to say I trust
him. He's definitely out there and doing it. He's the one that's bolting the coils together and sticking bits of wire on him and making things go bang with it, which is great. Yeah.
Well, I mean, as I said, that's not to say I'd invite him round and trust him, you know? So.
Certainly don't leave your wallet on the table.
Right. No, we shouldn't malign the man. But,
just to explain his importance to all of this is that Eric Dollard has a claim that he makes where, having fed an incredibly high current, incredibly high frequency, incredibly high voltage supply into a domestic radio-sized transmitter valve, which would be an enormous glass device with like a metal structure, a vacuum tube with an internal metal structure that was designed for either high-speed switching or emitting the radio signal or whatever. He was getting the used ones out the back of the Marconi factory and basically exploding them for his mates, whichever version of the story you like. Mm. And his claim was that when these things detonated, momentarily there appeared to be, fixed in space, beyond the collapse of the electric field, microscopic galaxies, strings of stars.
Yes.
So this is really why his work folds into the electric universe stuff.
Now, the story I heard, and I said this to you the other night, was the one where he was with Farnsworth, who, by the way, folks, Farnsworth was the original inventor of the television. Not many people seem to know this. You can look it up on Wikipedia, of course, and they will tell you some kind of a cock and bull story. And you can believe that if you choose. My investigations on Farnsworth are that yes, he was the one. Do you accept that, Jack? Would you go along with the Farnsworth?
I'm not familiar with him at all.
Oh, okay. Well, again, so Farnsworth would have liked to. Eric Dollard would visit with Farnsworth, who was apparently an even more eccentric individual than he was, but they got along, don't you know? And like that, he said, you know, the story went out there that you know, they churned in an enormous amount of juice into this valve, which didn't have an anode, apparently. It only had a cathode. And like that, then the thing went pop, but yet this micro galaxy just hung there. And they were all left scratching their heads till eventually it flashed out of existence.
And I was actually about to step onto that as a possible extraction from this failure of the redshift model, is in fact where we're assuming that these distant galaxies that are billions and billions of light years away and supermassive, and they may actually be very small and very close.
Mm.
We don't actually know of it, and we can't actually prove of a universe observably. We can't prove of a universe much beyond about 15, 20 light years mm-hmm. with parallax.
Mm-hmm.
And again, so everything outside of that, really, the sizes, the distances are virtually unknown and almost unknowable.
And unfathomable, practically.
Under the current model.
Now, you see, I think part of, I'm going to pitch in here, and I'm not sure exactly where you stand on this, Jack, but I will say this. I mean, I regularly tell people on here, I don't speak about my own spiritual beliefs, lack thereof, or otherwise, religious beliefs, or lack thereof, or otherwise, on radio. To me, that's my own personal private information and my private world. But I will say this, that there are people, I think, who have struggled because they say, well, hang on, if the universe is so unfathomably big, can there possibly be a God? I say, well, why not? Why not? And if people want to say, well, then that proves there isn't a God, well, if that's what you feel you need to, you know, I mean, to me, that's a personal thing, right? That's your own.
I'm personally an abject agnostic, but also possibly the most deeply mystic person that I know, and also the most deeply spiritual person that I know. Right. And I find absolutely no disconnect between the most rational form of deity that I'm finding. Really, if there is deity, it's likely to be a geometric shape.
Well, my favourite...
The Judeo-Christian concept of God... I began referring to him as the corridor prefect God.
Well, I
told you to take your hands out of your pockets and tuck your trousers.
As you know, I am a huge Douglas Adams fan, and one of my favorite all time reads, of course, Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. And there was a little ditty in there where they said Zapod Beeble. There was a machine, a device, folks. Essentially, what this device did, it showed you how insignificantly small you were compared to the rest of the entire universe. Somehow this device was purported to be able to do this. And in the book, it's a storybook, a science fiction storybook, but in the book, apparently this would send most people insane. And one guy did it, and apparently his ego was so big, he thought the universe looked pathetic next to him. Which I thought was kind of interesting. But, you know, I don't think we have to worry about how big or small we may or may not be in the entire universe. To me, that's insignificant.
I know how he feels.
Right, right. So to me,
a rampant egoist.
I mean, to me, I'm very happy with existing as I do, as I appear to. I'm very happy with my size and the structure of everything around.
Well, I mean, I would actually like to fold this subject back in.
Okay.
When we reach the digital virtual holographic reality theory,
okay.
Because then I'll actually be able to explain where my concept of deity fits into this model, and I actually think it's quite key.
Okay.
Because what at the moment we're looking at the macro. We're about to go through we're looking at the greater macro. We're about to go through the macro into the micro, and then when we go beyond the micro, we find the same thing reflected over and over again, just as a decreasing fractal.
Yeah,
a compacting, a compression of the same information field that's out there within the stars is exactly the same as in every single atom within us.
Yeah,
and that's quite a key, but crucial piece of information.
I mean, as an individual, you see, this is what I found fascinating. as an individual. I mean, think of just how important it is for us to be even to be able to say that to one another, Jack. It's a fascinating statement, even, you know, to say I am.
Absolutely,
it really is. It's just stunning, and it's a beautiful statement. I am. It really is. I mean, you know, as far as we're aware at the moment, there's no other creature on Earth that can do that. You know, maybe maybe they can, but we've no way of knowing as such, at least not to the same degree we seem to be able to.
Well, let's just stay with the electric universe for the minute before we get too esoteric here.
Okay, okay.
And explain why this is important for us on Earth, perhaps. Okay. And with that, we kind of touch on catastrophism and the Diluvian mythology.
Well, for example, the electric universe theory will assist us by studying the sun and understanding the sun as an electric arc discharge and all therein. We can use that to accurately predict earthquakes, volcanoes, you know, hurricanes. I mean, the most accurate predictor of hurricanes, I can't remember his name off the top of my head, but he's using the electric sun model to predict hurricanes, and he's more accurate than anybody.
And moreover, the fact that the electric universe guys are essentially suggesting that there is an actual electric circuit, a direct current transducing electrical circuit between the sun and all of the other planets. And that what will be happening as we orbit around the sun is as our orbit intersects the other planets, mm-hmm. that we'll be becoming under the influence of those large electric currents, which will have direct implications to planetary heating sea temperatures, plant growth,
everything.
You know what I mean, a predictable. But to our current model, unexpected sudden change in that condition could leave us with crop failures for hundreds of years.
And on top of that, you see, the resistance from the existing paradigm to this is because the electric universe model way more accurately and predictably will explain if indeed climate change / global warming / global cooling is happening, when it's going to happen, how it's going to happen, for how long it will happen, the duration, etc. And because that doesn't fit their narrative of CO2, and therefore somehow we can tax ourselves to death to somehow magically escape that, and they don't want that clearly, so they are resistant to all of the electric universe, I think, simply because of that one part.
I mean, fortunately, I suspect that all of their very slowly made plans of climate change agenda are likely to drag on for so long that the actual evidential observations of which way climate change is actually currently trending are going to become self-evident. And, you know what I mean, their model will just simply be obviously broken to every, you know what I mean, all and sundry.
Well, they keep altering their model anyway. I mean, they started off with the snowball Earth, and then they went into the fireball Earth, and then they had to find a passive phrase, a neutral phrase, and they just chose climate change. Because climate change, folks, you can apply anything to it, anything, at any time. It's a useful phrase, Jack, you see. Hot or cold, oh, it's climate change. Wind, no wind, oh, it's climate change, right? Whereas, you know, heating of the planet, well, oops, it's getting colder. Well, crap, what do we do? Pick a new phrase, climate change.
Well, the planet getting hotter and colder is certainly one thing that we can all be reasonably concerned about. But if Velikovsky was wrong with the model of Venus having been a captured comet, and in fact, I saw Velikovsky giving an entirely different version of that. He was not suggesting that at all. He was actually suggesting that Venus was effectively ejected
from Saturn.
Jupiter,
no,
out of the Great Red Spot.
I thought he said it was ejected from Saturn.
Well,
okay. Well, I need to. I tell you,
I heard him speaking personally,
right.
giving a seminar.
You could be right. Sorry, I think, in fact, you're correct. I think it came out of the red spot of Jupiter. The theory goes, folks, is that Venus was ejected from the red spot of Jupiter or a different...
Whichever model you're using, right. Venus arrives in the solar system as an unexpected new gravitational body.
A new hot body, fresh from the oven, and that it came over Saturn.
And spinning the wrong way, as has been observed now by the latest NASA missions.
And it came over Saturn... In other words, didn't crash into Saturn, but it came over Saturn, and as it came over Saturn, it disrupted everything for us. And this is why, of course, all the old Saturn worship is still out there, because essentially the EU model, folks, says that what we call the Sun today used to be the Sun, that in fact we were orbiting Saturn, and Saturn was glowing in a glow mode as our Sun.
There's two slightly differing models there. There's one where we had Saturn as our Sun, and we were orbiting Saturn, and there's another one where we were in a bi-orbit with our current Sun, but with Saturn in a completely different position, much closer to Earth and visible in the sky at all times.
Yeah, there's a few. As you say, there's two kind of operational models at the moment. But again, investigation by a lot of people possibly more clever than us, Jack, we'll be able to work this out eventually. And I think it's the most exciting time to be alive in regard to scientific discovery. You see, this is what scientific discovery is, folks. It's that we have to be honest enough to say we don't know. That's the beginning of science.
Just to complete the sort of catastrophist model of the solar system, so this Venus capturing event sends the solar system into temporary chaos. And as we suggested earlier, planetary collision is probably extremely unlikely because of the repulsive charges between planets.
Mm-hmm.
And what's actually more likely to happen is that you're going to have very close flybys where planets come hurtling past at fairly close ranges, and that this potential difference between the planets, as will happen with any Ball capacitor in a vacuum, if it's charged enough and brought into proximity of another charged object, then there will be a discharge and an equalization between the two objects. And so what we're actually looking at here is if this did happen, it's the chances are it changed Mars from having an interior orbit to Earth to having its current exterior orbit on the outside of the Earth's orbit. And as it transitioned from its previous orbit to its current orbit, it would have flown by in the sky three or four times the size of the moon, discharging enormous interplanetary lightning between the Earth, the moon and Mars, and hence we get the god of war, Mars, of mythology, that happens to hurl lightning bolts everywhere he goes.
Yeah, and apparently this all...
terrifying gods that are capable of such immense destruction and immense power.
And
these personified planets, basically.
What I'm going to say, which I found this, I was just watching an EU video earlier today, and I said to myself, I chuckled to myself, and apparently it all happened on a Thursday. And the reason I thought that is I thought, well, Thor being the god of thunder, Thor's day. it must have been a Thursday, Jack.
Yeah, absolutely.
I don't know what year, but it was a Thursday.
and moreover, that what this would suggest is that the great myths, the great planetary myths that appear to be almost archetypal across all primitive peoples appear to refer to some sort of broader catastrophe involving gods, usually these enormous deities that are weird shapes and weird energies and hurling lightning bolts around. All of this can be explained as an actual description of what these people witnessed, because this all happened within human, within human memory. So possibly, the Diluvian Age may well have been sort of 13,000, 14,000 years ago.
So, you see, what we're saying here, guys, is that this model, this story of the electric universe, it is a story. But it's a fantastic story, and the story is not being told tonight by me and Jack. The story is only being relayed by me and Jack. It was relayed by Emmanuel Velikovsky when he wrote that book, Worlds in Collision. But it's being told...
And currently taken up by the Thunderbolts of the Gods project, which is their rather unfortunate title, but it's actually a group of very serious scientists. And if you go to YouTube and type in Thunderbolts of the Gods, or what's their...
Just type in
Thunderbolts. It's just Thunderbolts Project, isn't it?
Electric Universe is just as good as any.
Yeah, yeah. But Thunderbolts Project will take you to the main Thunderbolts, and they do fabulous full-length documentaries. There's a whole range of scientific seminars from the most easy to understand to the very most complex of all of these subjects. It's a fabulous open school.
It is
knowledge,
but the point I was making was that we're just relaying this information. So are the EU guys. So was Emmanuel Velikovsky. But who was telling the story? And who's telling the story are the ancient people of Earth, and they told this story by carving all of these glyphs, hieroglyphs, call them what you will, into rock, and all around the entire planet there are ancient carvings. How ancient, we can't really be 100% sure, but there are ancient carvings in stone around the entire planet, folks, and they all have similar archetypes. And that logic and reason dictates this could not have been a planetary cult of some sort, because it would have morphed and changed as it went from A to B. But the fact that they're all there, they were preserved, regularly carved and recarved, it suggests that this is what the people could see. They could see this, Jack.
And also, most of the sort of primary religious symbolatry that has come down through all of the major religions is essentially still a throwback of this same sort of cultural ancestral information being encoded, yeah, even in modern religions.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I'm going to give you a for example here, folks. Imagine... most people can have no difficulty imagining the aurora. Most people have seen the aurora borealis over the poles. Now,
a coronal discharge event.
Absolutely. And what I'm trying to say here, if you imagine that that's actually coming visually, if you will, it looks like it's coming out of the pole and coming up. But if you could see that clearer, let's say you could magnify that or intensify that, you would notice above that would sit another auric field, I'm going to call it, that would be a big torus, like a donut. And then if you nest them one on top of the other, if the field was really, really strong, from the Scandinavian countries and Ireland and England and North America and all around there, as you looked to the pole on a dark night, you would see what would appear to be a huge towering form that, because you're looking through the vortex, the toroidal form would look effectively like a man with two legs and his arms stretched out with two dots under his arms. And that is found north and south, on, you know, within that visual range of the north and south.
As far as I know,
poles.
It's been found on every single continent.
Yes. But here's the beautiful... here's what I found was wonderful, Jack. The closer you go to the poles, the more the figure changed slightly, and as you go towards the equator, it elongated and the form altered slightly.
And that makes sense.
You see? Doesn't that make sense? And therefore, we can suggest that we can probably work out just how big that formation was.
From that's that, essentially the parallax of the curvature of the Earth changing the observed angle that you're seeing the vortex at, so it would elongate or fall short according to whether you're north or south.
Yeah. So, you know, and to boot, that the effects would also be, there would be different types of effects depending on what was happening and depending on the proximity of either celestial bodies to one another. As they got close enough, there were effectively like a pressure that could build up in the electric field, in the plasma field, and eventually it can literally snap on and go from dark mode into glow mode. And that's exactly what a neon light bulb does, Jack. You know?
Yeah, absolutely.
We, to this day, but folks, the,
but,
we
but
use
the
little...
point, but the point being that there is... This is the transition between dark mode plasma, this coronal discharge that issues no photons, so it's invisible to photography. It'd be very hard to read it on any Earth-based measurement device. this dark mode plasma, when it's being energized by a field, it essentially has a transistor-like switch phase, where instead of lighting up like a dimmer switch, it goes from not glow to glow mode.
Yeah, okay? It's kind of like
glow mode. We then go back to the archetypal sort of analog curve of power output.
Yeah, and it's almost like
Switching to glow mode is an incredibly high energy event. It requires tens of thousands, if not millions, of volts and amperes to drive any significant coronal discharge going into glow mode. So essentially, we live in a solar system that is incredibly likely to be absolutely full of these filaments of dark mode plasma that are interacting in exactly the same way that the glow mode stuff does, only because it hasn't transitioned to glow mode, the electric circuit isn't a direct circuit, it's an induced circuit. So it's like a magnetic induction rather than a wire. So instead of seeing the huge electrical discharges, we tend to get more electrical disturbances within our own electromagnetic field. And from what my studies are leading me to believe is that not only does the planet itself respond in a direct physical sense to these changes in its electrical field and its properties, but also all of our bodies and all of the plants and all of the animals will reflect this change in this field.
Yeah, and it's
and like I say, this field is basically impacted not only by the changes in the sun, but also in the sweep of the planets as they cross our orbit. Because this whole, as you say, with the bi-toroidal shape of the magnetic field around the Earth, exactly the same exists in the solar system. The entire solar system will be two big donuts stacked on top of each other, one with a rotational internal spiraling flow that's positive, and the one underneath will be negative, and this effectively is what causes all of the north and south alignments of all of the various planets, and it's why the planets actually exist in a disc, because they exist in the sort of space in between the two donuts, the place where the two donuts intersect, and that this is how the solar energy is driven in towards the center, which is why the planet that sits in the center, the heaviest planet of the lot, will be the one that lights up and becomes a sun.
Yeah, effectively, it sits in the place of lowest energy. That's because that's the way nature works. It tries to flow to the point of lowest energy. Everything is trying to lose energy. And the reason I was thinking about this is kind of like a bridge rectifier. Like, why is it always trying to lose this energy to get to the point of lowest energy? And essentially, it's so it can accept more.
Mm.
And that brings us
to the point is that all of these systems appear to be self-coherent, as in internally structured, so that they're self-recycling,
mm-hmm.
and that every output of entropic energy, shall we say, so heat being dispersed, doesn't disappear. It doesn't go out of the solar system. It's recirculated by the solar system.
It's in fact, it's by all
these toroidal fields and basically funneled back into the center through the planets and into the sun.
Essentially, it's all being funneled towards, as I say, to the lowest possible point, ready, and I'm going to use the phrase, to transform any more available energy that can come its way, essentially.
Mm. But if the sun is this heaviest object, or most dense, most massive object in the solar system that we understand under this asymmetrical electron model, then what we're actually looking at is it would be the greatest disturber of the electron fields, the electron orbits around all of the atoms within its electrostatic reach. And because unlike gravity, which being so weak drops off very quickly, electricity is exactly the same as light. It's subject to the inverse square law. So basically it reduces in field and effect at a rate of four times magnitude by each one times in distance,
mm-hmm.
but that never goes to nothing.
And you see, for example, that was one of the things that kind of bugged me the first time I was being taught about, the atom in school in science, and they were saying, okay, we got the shells around the electron, first one is K, L, M, N, blah, blah, and the ones in the that you got 2, and then 8, and then, and I'm going, wait a minute. I remember thinking, well, okay, so I can see why 2 can orbit in there, okay, fine, and then 8 out here, and then so forth and so on, 16, 32, and I was thinking, well, what's holding the ones out? Why are more on the outside than on the inside? It just didn't make sense.
I actually now suspect that the solar system kind of model for the atom, which is the one that we're given with the nucleus as the sort of sun in the middle with its huge attractive force and the electrons being like tiny little planets circling around as little hard marbles of energy circling around the central nucleus. I think we're actually probably, with the actual imaging that we're getting back from the atomic labs, I would actually suggest that a galactic model would probably be more appropriate, where the nucleus was simply the galactic centre and that what we perceive as electrons are merely orbiting clusters of stuff, and that when we see those electron rings, that's basically like taking a fixed sample, like taking a cookie cutter and taking a slice out of a solar system and counting the number of stars that intersect the cookie cutter.
Mm-hmm. Well,
and
yeah,
that could possibly be a more.
Well, I think it's important at this stage probably to mention that the norm for stars, folks, as far as we can tell, is binary systems. That appears to be the norm, not necessarily equal binary systems, but certainly binary. And it would imply, perhaps, is it a case, Jack? Perhaps Jupiter, in its youth, as it were, in glow mode, perhaps it was the binary of what we call the sun today. Was it its binary partner?
Well, like I say, the electric universe guys would suggest that that would have been Saturn. But again, it's hard to say with sort of planetary densities, because again, instead of understanding the actual mechanics of the planets themselves, we're using this ridiculous gravitational model which has no underlying mechanics to explain how it works, and so the assumed weights of the planets are purely down to their orbital mechanics, and assuming that somehow this gravitational model implies to them and that there's no electrical force involved. Now, if those planets happen to be extremely electrically active, then they may be much less dense than what they appear to be.
Well, how about we talk...
much more dense, conversely, depending on whether it's a repulsive or an attractive charge.
Well, look, I'm going to throw a couple of what I call solar system oddities. Neptune and Uranus, they appear to have been, in my opinion, at one stage, a binary setup. It's not unheard of for, you know, suns, stars, and planets to literally go a-wandering through the galaxy. It's not unheard of. They will flow, again, they will go down to the lowest level, lowest energy levels, it seems, waiting to transform, as it were, more energy.
When they first started computer modelling solar systems, this was one of the problems that they suffered from with the early models and why they rejected.
You can't model them with gravity. You just can't do it.
Well, not only that, but what they were finding was that they kept having planets that, after a very short time of running in a reasonably ordered, structured nature, would suddenly start orbiting each other.
Yep. Yeah, suddenly they'd come close to one another on a flyby each other, and suddenly they'd say, you know what, let's dance, and they'd go spinning around each other. And it was destroying their model.
Each other out of the solar system.
Yeah.
Like whirligig dancers on a dance floor.
Yeah, and it doesn't make sense. And you see, because you look at, for example, what they call the alignments of the planets. And let's say, I mean, I think it was about a year and a half ago, we could see 5 planets in the night sky. I was out here with my children pointing them out, Jupiter and Saturn and Mars and Venus and Mercury.
That with Mars being how it's visible in the current night sky, that anybody could ever associate that with some sort of god of war. That's an almost ubiquitous, you know, I mean, an archetypal application across all sorts of cultures. That Mars is this incredible godlike creature with ridiculous superpowers.
Yeah.
And it's a red dot in the sky.
Yeah. But that's what I'm saying.
Scary.
So what I'm saying is one, I could bring my children out and I pointed out Saturn, Venus, Jupiter, Mercury. And of course we had the moon. and all in the night sky visible together. And they were due to, I think there was four or five coming into alignment. In a gravitational model.
Around 2012, there was the Astral Cross and another couple of consecutive alignments there.
In a gravitational model, Jack, one would have expected all those planets, well, we're all closer together, they would have all been attracted to one another if it were gravity, right?
Yeah.
And guess what, folks? That didn't happen.
I'm sure that the gravitational model guys would say that it was because the inertia of the motions of the planets was greater than their gravitational attraction, so there was no measurable effect. But again, would anybody ever actually run the data to actually find out whether that was true or whether they just simply lean on their 200-year-old model and say, nope, the model's still right?
Well, the problem with that is, of course, is that you soon realise, well, hang on a second, somewhere between, say, Earth and the Moon, the gravity cancels out. We call them Lagrange points. That's what we call them, yeah? Where we put geostationary satellites going. There's five Lagrange points around the Earth. L1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, right? Do you remember Lagrange? It was the mathematician that gave his name, Lagrange, for these points in space. And he reckoned, well, somewhere between the Earth and the Moon's gravity would be cancelled out by the Earth's gravity, and there'd be this point of lowest energy, as it were, and that would be a perfect point to plop a satellite because it would take almost no energy to keep the thing there. Yeah, so there are five Lagrange points. Actually, I'll dig that up on Wikipedia, actually, because it's an interesting little... Have you ever looked at the Lagrange points, no?
No, I know that they exist, but no, I've not thought about it in this context.
Oh, okay. And again, Lagrangian points, Lagrange, how was he pronounced? Lagrange.
Yeah, no, it's Lagrange, you're right.
Yeah. I'll just copy it and stick it in the chat box there. Folks want to have a little peek. But I found this interesting. So I looked at this and I thought, sorry, have you got that link, Jack?
No, I'm not in the chat at the minute. I've closed all my internet connection.
There you go.
Chuck it in the chat. All right, thanks.
Yeah. So have a look at that for me. And you see, I look at that with I'm going to say an electric universe eye.
So the image with the L1s to L5s. I would really like to see that same thing modelled with all of the planets in some relative position.
My dogs are barking here. They need to get out. They're going to wee themselves. Hold on.
Do you want to put a tune on? Because I think we're probably going to be getting close to needing to move on to electric biology, really.
Okay, back in a second. And welcome back to peoplesinternetradio.com. My dogs work bow-legged, cross-legged, whatever you want to call it. They needed to get out and do their business. So everything's okay now for the moment.
I've been having to mute my mic out every few minutes to tell my dog to shut up because she kept slurping and licking herself so loudly.
There you go. Well, we're back. Okay, I think it's a good time. I think it's a good time now, Jack, that we move forward into... Before we do...
Yeah, I think there's probably a bit of summation required here.
Well, yeah. Before we do, what I want to say is... The question that would be in my mind at this stage if I'd been listening to us so far, and I'm going to apologise because we have sort of been incoherently rambling on a bit. I don't know if you've noticed. We've been kind of jumping all around the place.
Absolutely not.
Yeah, we have. Trust me, we have. And so I'm going to apologise to you folks. We will try to do... Once we get connection problems and Jack can't hear me and I couldn't hear him, we were talking over each other and it's frustrating. But we will probably do a better presentation eventually. A calmer presentation. It's a pity we weren't recording our conversation the other night, Jack, because we had a great connection and we had an in-depth...
Did say that, didn't I?
Yeah, I know. But I'm going to say that everything in every single physical body we can see seems to be acting like a transformer. In other words, the EU theory is saying, essentially, the sun is not lit, as it were, from the inside. It's lit from the energy arriving from the outside. It seems the same.
Essentially, the million degree temperatures that you were referring to earlier with the sun's corona is exactly the same temperatures that we see in a lightning discharge.
Yeah, and they're external. So, in other words, the energy is coming in from the outside. not what the traditional model would have you believe, that it comes from the inside out.
Yeah, it's becoming coronal, and as it becomes coronal, it's heating the surface of the sun beneath, which is what we see as the boiling of the surface underneath.
Yeah, so that's why I used the phrase transformer, that the sun is transforming, if you will, all the energy that's arriving to it. The earth is transforming all the energy that arrives to it, and we on the earth,
and
we
again,
transform.
That would also explain the 5,000 degree surface temperatures that we appear to be recording, because that would be the approximate temperature of molten rock.
Right, and yeah. we, as it were,
and again, according to this toroidal model as well, it's also radiating that received energy back into space as visible light, which we receive, but this is also contained within this self-circulatory double toroidal model, where all the energy that's coming in is being taken out at exactly the same sort of roughly equivalent rate and as entirely recirculated at some later point.
Right, but the point I'm trying to get you to, let me finish this, because I'm trying to bring it to electrobiology here. I'm trying to get the conversation to electrobiology, okay?
Yes, absolutely.
Because we need to move on. So what I'm saying is the sun transforms this energy. It transforms as much as it possibly can. What it can't cope with gets pushed back out again in the form of photons and light and heat, radiation, energy, etc. That arrives at the Earth. The Earth does the same thing. It takes in as much energy as it possibly can. And so do the creatures on Earth. We do the same thing, folks. We take as much energy as we can. And we can only convert approximately 10% of the food that we eat, for example, into what we call energy, and the rest we push away. And we try to, you know, because just because you can eat doesn't mean you should eat 24/7, right? I mean, you know.
Well, the biology on the planet is in fact increasing the tonnage of the planet by a quite significant amount, and there's quite a lot of argument as to whether or not that amount is actually increasing or whether there's some mechanism by which it's then lost to space through other mechanisms. But certainly the actual mass of soil on the planet is constantly increasing due to the action of biology, and that's actually increasing the physical mass of the planet due to the conversion of sunlight through photosynthesis.
Right, but so I'm down to creatures our size, and as we get down to smaller and smaller creatures, then when we get down to single-celled creatures, they, of course, are doing exactly the same thing that the sun and the stars and the planets and the galaxies are doing, which is they are transforming. It's a transformative structure. The single cell creature, if you will, is transforming the energy that's made available to it, but it only as much as it can cope with. When a cell is in a state that there's too much around it, it tries to literally move away again, or to get to a lower level of equilibrium, consume the energy to maintain itself, and then it goes and seeks more energy. Does that make sense, Jack?
Absolutely, absolutely.
Right.
So really, we've kind of got this picture of our planet in an electromagnetic solar system, where we have effectively we're sat upon a ball magnet with a north and south pole, and if it were a magnet and we were to stick it under a bit of paper and sprinkle some iron filings onto it, we would have a visual representation of the lines of magnetic force, and all magnetism is electricity and all electricity is magnetism. They're interchangeable concepts. That we would see the Earth as effectively a three-dimensional sort of hedgehog with clusters at its top and bottom, with clusters at its poles, where the lines of force came much closer together, become much tighter, and with those lines of force distributing towards the equator. And when we actually look at the distribution of biology on the planet, there appears to be this sweet zone, not quite up where, near the poles where the lines of force are all gathered really tightly together and the temperatures tend to be very cold, and not down near the equator where the sun's really hot and where there's very little of this magnetic force available.
Well, what I'm going to suggest is that nature at the micro and macro level seems to be operating with this transformative, would you call it, mode. In other words, all this plasma-based energy that's arriving, we're all doing our damnedest, if you will, to accept as much as we possibly can, transform it, and then use it to either repair ourselves, grow, and, you know, live our lives, if you will, at our level. And then when we need more, we seek it. But all of it comes from the same source.
Well, I think the reason why I've settled on the study of plants primarily in my electric biology theory, just to I need to nail my colours to the mast. This is the actual reason for my sweaty nerves about coming on air this evening, is that I have been pursuing this subject voraciously for 2 years solidly, for at least 3 years prior to that. So this is now a culmination of nearly 5 years worth of work, thanks to some incredibly kind donations. I've got a microscope and reasonably good enough quality to be able to call scientific digital voltmeter, winging its way to me as we speak. I've also invested in a dirt cheap voltmeter just to keep me going for the time being, and my observed results with the data that I'm collating off of my plants currently is suggesting that I may be so close to actually having a fundamental breakthrough in the biological sciences that I'll be looking for a fellow biologist, hopefully an academic with qualifications, in order to seek co-publication.
Okay,
so, well, this subject is not only crucially important to me, but is in fact, well, essentially the
absolutely
the resultant work of the sweat of my brow over the last 5 years. And I honestly think that I'm at a groundbreaking, science-changing breakthrough moment with my researches, and those researches are completely absent elsewhere. The nearest I can find to my work is a book from 1890. And that's actually about, funnily enough, the magnetic fields near the poles.
It would be, of course,
the growth of plants there, strangely.
Well, maybe we should just acknowledge that that the PIR donation helped out in that regard, and that, you know, that's kudos to all the listeners, because Jack was talking to me about what he was trying to do, and of course I'm a huge supporter of the Electric Universe theory and everything therein. So it was assistance from PIR,
and for such an incredible challenge as well. It only needed to be a very moderate sum. It's just that my finances just simply wouldn't allow me to stretch to it, and I broke my previous instrument by leaving it out in the rain.
Yes, you naughty boy! Don't do that again.
Digital electronic devices don't like being filled with rainwater, particularly when they've got a battery in them.
Don't break your scientific equipment. Rule number one.
Yeah, so that's kind of and moreover, the nerves that this is generating in me may make my ability to express this subject to my fullest somewhat hindered. But I want to try and kind of sort of take over a little here, and maybe just give an initial foundation in what I'm theorizing and some of the discoveries that's sort of been leading me to.
Please
and
do.
Certainly the work that I've been publishing, I have been publishing it to Google Docs and posting it to academics, and so far I haven't received any really dismissive replies to it. So it's currently peer reviewed and stands as a model, and my research data now appears to be supporting the original model. So if I can just explain the basic principles of electrobiology and in respect simply to the plant-based model, I think it's safe to say that this will be extrapolatable directly to the microbiological level and to the macrobiological level. But currently I need to have a simple model of something that I can use as an observable data set, and that's what I'm building my model upon. So effectively I'm working from the moment that a seed germinates to the moment that the plant dies, and I'm trying to look for a mechanism that will explain all of the functions that are required to achieve that, and all of the actions that are seen to require some sort of energy to achieve that result.
Okay, so I'm going to step out now, Jack, and just let you go for it, okay?
Okay, all right, well, I'll try and make it as brief as possible. My suggestion is this, that, like I say, with this ball magnet model, if you sprinkle the iron filings on it, you get this sort of porcupine effect of the lines of force. Now, I suggest that's what you're seeing there is the macro structure of the magnetic lines of force. Those lines of force don't actually exist. What they are is greater and lesser regions of magnetic polarity, and that these segregate themselves out into lines of positive and negative, and this basically forces the iron filings to both attract and reject themselves in sort of waves. So the iron filings don't perfectly model the effect. If you were to actually be able to see the electromagnetic Earth as it really exists, it would be like some phenomenally tangled porcupine of masses of spines poking out of the Earth of all varying sizes and proportions and colors and shapes. And my suggestion is that the strength of the field of these spikes is in fact the determining factor in the successful germination of a seed. Now, the reason why some seeds appear to germinate absolutely anywhere, and some seeds seem to be far more picky, choosy about where they choose to germinate, is because of the type of the material that the plant is going to require to manufacture its body parts is going to be interdependent on the strength of the field required to move those body parts about the body of the plant. So, God, I'm fucking nervous. Oh, excuse my language. I'm pouring with sweat already. I'm only 2 minutes in. Okay. So essentially, we have this germination moment at which the seed and the electric field that it requires in order to be able to trigger the first of the germination processes come together about a moment in space and time. And if the moisture content of the surrounding soil is correct, then what actually happens is that the field switches. Like a transistor switches from positive to negative with a very basic. I need to explain a gate transistor. Effectively, all of our modern electronics works on this thing called a gate transistor. All amplifiers require it. Essentially, what a gate transistor is it's a switch. But this switch can carry some fairly large current. But in order to switch the switch, it doesn't need a human finger. It requires a small sensor wire. That goes in and just applies the little bit of extra current that's required to make this circuit collapse. It's actually a quantum event. It's to do with the nature of silicon and its electrical properties. But it's effectively another one of these strange events that's like a switch in electrical terms. Now, what I'm suggesting is that when the field and the seed and the moisture around the seed achieve this perfect equilibrium, this switch state, this transistor state is achieved where now the seed suddenly becomes hugely attractive to positively ionized water molecules. And it will literally draw all of the water that it needs. It will suck it from all of the soil around it. So this is how a seed goes from bone dry on effectively reasonably dry soil and suddenly has enough water to be able to fill all of its cell walls up and begin the process of becoming a zygote of lowering the root tip and pushing out the top. So we've got germination now solved and the finding of the water required to begin the process of building a plant. Now, the first thing that the plant does is it pokes out a root out of a midpoint roughly on the seed normally. And this root tip has got some dense minerals in it. Now, these dense minerals are heavier than the rest of the plant, so they fall. And these act basically like a pendulum or like a plumb bob, shall we say, and point the root down. Now, as soon as the root begins its way down, I watch seeds germinating in minute detail. I've sat and watched through, I mean, these stop frame videos and stuff. The root begins its descent. Before any shoot will begin to come out of the seed. Now, my suggestion is that this root needs to go far enough away from the main seed body in order to separate the charge. And once that root begins to go down into the ground, it will become an antenna for something called cation exchange. Now, cation exchange is the one thing that you will find in the textbooks. Cation exchange is the process by which positively charged ionic water, that is water that's bearing nutrients, nitrogen, potassium, calcium, and these sort of minerals, all of which carry a heavy positive electrical charge and ionize the water around them. These droplets of ionized water, acid rain, whatever it is, go into the body of the soil and are captured by the minerals within that soil. Now, all of the decent crop-growing soils around the planet are basically a version of powdered mica or silicon, of quartz. The thing with both of these substances is, on the microscopic scale, they are A, neutrally electrically charged, and B, electrically capacitant, and C, huge surface areas compared to their tiny size. Basically, all quartzes and micas are the things we use in electric lighters and in your silicon devices, because it's a semiconductor. So essentially, it has an electrical property. It's not like a copper wire, but it does have certain electrical properties. Now, the reason why this is important is because this can now hold on to this positively charged water, but not taking up all of its positive charge. The capturing force is a weak force. Now, what now happens is that the plant, with its sap in its stem, which will be positively charged up near the seed, but will carry a because of the charge separation, anywhere where there's a strong positive charge, the other end of the circuit will automatically go to negative. So down inside the actual sap in the root, anything below the soil carries a negative charge and is mildly alkaline. Now, as the root begins to detect through the electrical properties of the plant that the plant is beginning to dry out and needs water, that will automatically open a pore in the root. The drying process will be probably what's involved with opening the pore in the root. And this will now give the sap, the negatively charged sap, the alkalinic sap inside the root, will basically now exert an electrocapacitant force on all of the water molecules in the surrounding soil, which will now begin to migrate towards that pore. So literally, the plant electrically sucks the water out of the soil around it. Now, having sucked all of this protonic water, all of this ionic, positively charged water into its sap, now you have a whole bunch of positive ionic water within a body of negative alkaline water, and the two are going to charge separate again. So this new water, as it enters the body, is going to have the natural tendency to be buoyant and to rise towards the other end of the charge. So basically head up towards the seed. Now, not only have we now got a fully formed primary electric circuit in the seed and taproot, but this has also now created essentially an axis around which, a central axis, a vertical axis, which not only points down because of the pendulum effect of the weights in the root, but also through extraction points the way up. So now the root, the tip, is now full of positive ionic water, which is going to be attracted to the negative sky. And literally, the growing tip isn't pushed upwards out of the soil, it's pulled by the sky. So are you getting me so far?
Yeah, absolutely. Fascinating. Go ahead. Keep going with this, John. Keep going, my friend. I'm not going to say a dicky bird.
Once this tip has emerged from above the positively charged surface of the soil, with its charge being attracted by the sky, what we actually see in the form that it takes is that the seedling appears to have a set distance above the ground to which it can grow, and it can't grow any further. Now, under certain conditions, that will vary a little bit within a certain specific variety, but generally speaking, any given seed of any given plant, if you put it in the soil and give it average conditions, it will grow exactly the same height, and then the leaf will open. Then what will happen is that the next little bit will come out, and it will grow a little bit less than the one before did, before it stops completely. And what happens at this point is it bifurcates. It splits into two, sometimes three. And what I suggest is that what's actually happening there is that the electrostatic pump that's pushing the water up from the roots and is sucking the tip up from the sky is drawing a voltage, a charge separation between the positiveness of the growing tip and the negativeness of the root. And according to the specific circumstances of that particular plant design, that there's going to be a fixed parameter at which that all stops, where essentially there's no longer enough pump at the top or pull at the bottom to achieve any further growth. At this point, the plant has no other option. Yeah, it has to bifurcate. What it does is it then separates that charge. And if you can imagine the plant as a ball capacitor where charges equalize across the surface, then effectively what the plant is doing is it's exploiting this electrocapacitant space. And that what I'm suggesting is that things like the internodal distances between the branches, the gaps in between the branches, that every possibly a lot of the listeners will have heard that plants adhere to the Fibonacci sequence and that they adhere to Phi. Well, this is why. It's because Fibonacci and Phi are intricately tied to electric capacitance. That the 120 degree rule of the circular spacing of branches and leaves around a branch is down to it's like the left hand and the right hand rule. It's Faraday's law. And that essentially once you kind of pierce the electric envelope by putting out a new branch, you have now completely changed the local field around that branch, allowing a new interval of growth, which is a proportion, a phi proportion of the previous interval of growth, because you're stretching a capacitant sphere which has certain electrostatic effects over the sizes that are available within that surface. And so essentially the reason why plants put out more and more branches and more leaves is simply so that they can continue to exploit their electrostatic field. And I would suggest that probably the majority of plants, the reason why they grow to a certain size and no more is because that's the sort of size of the antenna that they're designed to fit, and that would be the height that the electric field dictates at that particular, under those particular conditions. So there's electrobiology in a nutshell. Oh, just to go one further than that as well, that once the sap is being transported up the leaves, that essentially the pores in the leaves have exactly opposite response to those in the roots, in as much as that they are open when the plant is wet, and as the plant dries and the surface of the leaf shrivels up, that those pores naturally shrink. So essentially a well-hydrated plant will be electrostatically spraying its sap into the air as like a micro spray all the time that the pump's active. And as soon as the pump pressure begins to die off and the leaf dries out a little, it will automatically close those pores in the leaf just as a natural matter of, as an actual feature of the evaporative process drying the leaf out a little.
Wow. That is an incredible description, Jack. And I'm sitting here listening to this. And of course, you know, me being me, I'm of course applying all the other layers of stuff and knowledge, which I'm sure you've done yourself, on top of that as you're describing it to me. So I'm sitting here thinking, okay, I was waiting for the phi to come in. I knew Fibonacci was coming in. I knew it. And I'm thinking, okay, and it's going to go, is this why the Fibonacci sequence is zero? So there's your stem. One, first leaf. One again, next leaf. But now you have two leaves, so they can push out the next level.
Yep.
Because, as you say, there's a charge difference. And
this also explains why it's not strict Fibonacci. It's close.
Yes.
On certain things, it's exact, but it's not.
It's environmentally.
When you go and take the measurements, the claims don't quite stack.
No, because it's environmentally affected, isn't it? You know, the plant will. It has this ability
to.
It'll
be near. It's using it as an approximation.
Yes. In other words, yes, the plant has this. But essentially, what you're saying is that the plant itself is not using the Fibonacci sequence as a use this end of story. There's another function in there. Use this if you can.
Specifically, what this is that this isn't even encoded into the DNA. This information is actually received by the plant directly from its environment.
That's what I'm saying. It doesn't have to be.
But essentially, the shape of the plant is actually a direct proportional response to its electrical environment. And even things like the shapes of the leaves, I suspect, are actual. Would effectively, if you can imagine the plant as frozen plasma, as a frozen coronal discharge, as lightning turned upside down and stuck in the ground. That's effectively what we're seeing. And all of the shapes of the lead, the shape, even because you have to explain the transport of certain materials from one part of the plant to another part of the plant and them arriving in the right number, in the right order, and getting into the right place. That can't be encoded into DNA. The DNA is just the brick factory. It just makes the proteins.
I've had this conversation with you.
It can't order the biology.
I've had this.
For me,
yeah.
Electrobiology explains the morphology of plants.
Of course.
The shapes of the structures that we see. And not only that, what I'm finding is that the things like the differences between, say, the conifers and the broadleaves are down to the electrostatic environment they naturally occupy.
Has to be.
The electrostatic environment above the tree line for the broadleaf plants is a very different electrostatic environment to the one below it.
As I was saying, so in other words, that the Fibonacci, the plant, if you will, inverted commas, is adapting to, or is using, for want of a better term,
yes,
the Fibonacci sequence where it can, but it's not saying, well, I need to put out, I have to follow the Fibonacci sequence here, but my environment isn't provide. Let's say the environment stops providing the requisite energy,
if
water.
The environment is asymmetrical, say the tree's growing up next to a wall.
Yeah, so in other words, that's what I'm saying. So therefore it goes, well, I need to push up an extra bit until I can get back to the Fibonacci again, if you will, because that's the point of lowest.
To be quite honest, it's actually more that the Fibonacci is a reflection, an implicit part of the function of electrocapacitance. So really what you're seeing there is the Fibonacci is not a directly encoded thing. It's more a response to the way that, basically, if you can imagine the plant as a succession of larger and larger spheres as it grows. Now, if you can imagine that as the top of a Van de Graaff generator, you know the Van de Graaff generator. Well, I was going to say
right,
make hair stand on.
I'm not. Hang on, but maybe you're confusing me, or maybe you're confused with what I'm saying. I'm not suggesting for a moment the Fibonacci is encoded.
Okay.
What I'm suggesting is because any body, it seems, in the universe that's receiving energy, it always tries to get to the lowest charge, the equilibrium, the lowest point. And that is, the nodes on the Fibonacci are the lowest point. And as you say, therefore, it doesn't have to be encoded.
Yeah.
Because those nodes are the lowest point where the plant, essentially, if the plant has, say, built up energy, say, if it's building up energy inside, and as you say, the environment it is in isn't facilitating, say, as you say, a textbook, here's how you grow a plant in ideal circumstances, because no plant grows in ideal circumstances. So it will still have the ability, of course, to do other things, because if the Fibonacci was programmed in, it wouldn't have the ability to do this, would it?
No, and
right.
And moreover, that I defy anybody to go and look at a beech tree, a mature beech tree, and find me an accurate Fibonacci or phi anywhere on that plant. The only one that you really can absolutely guarantee is that you can take a leaf off of that plant, and if the tree is growing in free space, if it's not a forest tree, if it's growing on the top of a hill or something, you can take the leaf of that plant, you can hold it up and obscure the entire tree behind one of its leaves. And if you block out the tree with the leaf between your eye and the tree,
we'd lost you again.
Exactly match the shape of the mature tree.
This is
a fractal.
This connection is driving me nuts, Jack. It keeps dropping off at the very moment when we don't want it to.
Did you hear the bit about the leaf obscuring the shape of the tree?
Yes.
Right, okay, well, that was pretty much all that I was saying, is that essentially the leaf obscures the shape of the tree because the leaf and the tree are both fractals.
Of
and
course.
The fractals are dependent on this shape of this field, and the shape of this field in order to understand how the maths play into the reality, play into the shapes of the morphology.
Right.
It has to be understood from these layers of ball capacitance. Because effectively, with these internodal spaces, if we take the idealized fractalized tree, so we take a trunk, we split it twice, we take each of those branches, and we split those twice until we end up with a nice ball-shaped lollipop tree. Okay, if each of those bifurcation points distances are mapped as the surface of a sphere, we're now talking about a ball capacitor, the similar to like the likes of the Van de Graaff generator that most people are familiar with, that makes your hair stand on end, and you can stick balloons to it and make all sparks and wonderful things with it. Now, effectively, the mathematics of ball capacitors are intrinsically connected to things like Faraday's law, Gauss's, Maxwell's equations. All of the fundamentals of known electrics are within this consideration of this ball capacitance. And that this extends out again to the electric universe theory. So this is quite a crucial piece of understanding. Now, because of this, the same way that when you dust the iron filings onto the paper, they form discrete lines of iron filings, no iron filings, iron filings, no iron filings. Like I say, that's this ordering effect of these lines of magnetic field that grow out around any electromagnetic object. Now, what this means is that we have to consider these ball capacitors as independent like a Russian doll, yeah, with a smaller sphere inside of a bigger 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 sphere. Now, each one of these ball capacitors will be in charge equilibrium. So the charge at that radius from the centre will be exactly the same wherever you measure it. So essentially this dictates how far a branch can grow at that specific point. Once it's exceeded that point, now the next size ball is a larger radius, and because pi r squared, a much larger, well, pi r cubed actually for the surface of a sphere, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
We have an incredibly increased surface area with only a very small increase of radius. And because the same amount of charge is being distributed over a much larger surface area, the internodal distance has to be shorter.
Of course.
And so that is how the Fibonacci is encoded in. And it's simply because the Fibonacci is so deeply embedded within the nature of the electric force that the plant is adhering to, that we see Fibonacci being expressed through the nature of the plants that we see.
Okay, now I'm going to just stop you for a second and say, okay, so you know I know my Fibonacci sequence and all of that, and I understand the fractal nature of the structure of everything we see around us, and we've already said that with, you know, stars are essentially no different than planets, which are no different essentially than the creatures on the planets, which is no different essentially from the microbiology, and indeed the atoms themselves. So we have this fractal relationship, we have the Fibonacci relationship, we have the electrodynamic relationship, I'm going to call it, and we have the fractal Fibonacci dynamic relationship. And what you've explained there, now I've been just sitting here listening quietly to you, that is, Jack, that's truly stunning. That is absolutely stunning. And I actually think you're completely correct. I want to hear more. We're very short on time. And yep. What I'm going to say to you is it's a long time since I shook your hand. I think I need you to get on a feckin' plane or a boat, Jack, and come over, because I want to sit down with you and talk this through and film it. I need you to get on a boat or a plane, man. Because we need to be together in the same room to do this, I think.
This is unbelievably important. If this works out, I mean, I don't want to publish the results too early because they're so tentative. But just to make an easy point, I've got plants that are growing in an incredibly enclosed environment here that I'm able to test. Mm-hmm. I rigged up a voltmeter to them today, and I was actually able to read from the voltmeter the level of ventilation that I was allowing them while they were under lights. So if I restricted the ventilation, the voltage dropped. If I allowed full ventilation, the voltage would return and was repeatable. So I suspect that I may even be able to simply go out into the field, and if somebody has an unhealthy crop, let's say, I may be able to take an ordinary 10 quid Maplin's voltmeter, chuck it one probe in the ground, chuck one probe in the plant, and be able to say, oh, you need fungi, or you need more bacteria, or you need more nematodes.
Which, of course, has huge potential, particularly for what I love, biodynamic farming.
Mm.
Essentially, biodynamic farming, from what I can tell, if done correctly, essentially establishes the correct electrical properties for everything to literally produce naturally and abundantly in. It's a balance of electric fields, essentially, with whatever conditions you have available. And slowly over time, the biodynamic aspect seems to improve soil, improve plants, improves the fruits, improves the water.
Every farmer is aiming for a pH in their soil of 7.2. Well, 7.2 is neutral. It's neither positive or negative. And I've explained exactly why the soil has to be pH neutral with my electrobiology theory, which is completely absent from any of the textbooks, which will be telling you to throw lime on it or throw this on it or throw that on it to simply change the chemical properties with no understanding of what that chemical property is actually an indication of or a requirement for.
As I said, we need to get you on a boat or a plane and get you over here. Well, I mean, I'm serious because I haven't seen you in ages.
No, I'm game. I've got to push this. I've been carrying the shadows for far too long, but it has at least, you know, in my time away from the air, I was driving myself a bit batty. And we haven't even gone into digital holographic reality theory,
which is
the fundamental source of all of this for me, is that it was the digital virtual holographic reality theory and my work with Ted Voller's.
Well, you see, this is it. We have 10 minutes. We have 10 minutes left.
We have 10 minutes, but I've just got to get this out. Just to fit this in really quickly, that what actually dialed back into this was my work with Ted Voller's, the American physicist. I'd be very surprised if he's still with us. It was 89 back then. But he's one of the co-authors of the My Big Toe theory with Tom Campbell. But he's the actual physicist. Campbell's only a statistician.
Okay, skip the details. Campbell,
but off air, I was working privately with Ted Voller. His throat was too knackered and he couldn't come on the mic. But he actually was dear, dear to me and treated me with kid gloves all the way through. I sent him my numerical flux and the computational mainframe theory, which was my effort to take the digital virtual reality holographic theory out of where Campbell stopped at other and into some sort of a computational structure on which the holographic reality could be processed and expressed, i.e. consciousness. And he was kind enough to reply that not only had my two-page theory basically summed up 50 pages of the MBT book with almost perfect clarity and perfection, but I'd also taken the theory one step further and managed to sort of bring a bit more of an explicable rationale to that particular part of the plenum theory's section of MBT. So for me, this all really stems from looking for the algebraic, numeric, and geometric nature that underlies the fractals that we're seeing in the plants and the animals and the planets. It's the substrate of reality.
So do you mean to tell me, now correct me if I'm wrong here, Jack.
Mm-hmm.
Are you telling me you think you may have discovered the actual, I'm not going to call it the source of consciousness, but the framework for consciousness?
The framework for reality.
Repeat that last bit.
With consciousness.
No. Clearly repeat that again. Just give me that one more time. And of course,
as its primary source.
We've just lost the mic. Do it again. Sorry, do it again. Yeah, I'm sorry.
I'm losing you again.
This is why I need to get you over
here. Okay, essentially, this is the framework of reality. Okay. The framework of reality is algebraic, numeric, and appears to be an interface with this thing that we perceive as consciousness. And that this appears to be a two-way street where we both interact with the stuff that makes up reality, but we also regurgitate our own input into that data field. And that most of what we experience as hard stuff, reality, is simply a holographic representation within a digital virtual rule set. And the computational mainframe on which that is being computed is entirely numeric. and self-emergent. It invented itself.
Yeah.
And everything that occupies it. Can you call that God? I don't know.
Wow.
It's God to me. Stars look pretty shiny to me.
Get on a plane. Get on a plane now.
And with that, folks, I think we're at 11:53. You want to put a tune on?
No, get on a plane now.
Let me get some results. Give me a month or so.
Okay.
I've got a millionaire's bloody hydro system to go and design and install in the next couple of weeks. Give me a break, man.
Wow.
Jack. I'm only just off my deathbed for the last week. I mean, flat on my back for the last 3 months. I'm 7.5 stone.
Eat something. Quick.
Oh, I'm eating like a horse now, mate. Now I'm back up and on my feet. Two yoga moves. Doctors filling me full of pills, pain pill after pain pill, like stronger and stronger ones. Finally got to see a new Indian doctor. Oh, yeah, no, just do this yoga move. Look over your shoulder, look over the other shoulder, fix on a point on the wall behind you. Do that twice a day. 2 days sorted. 3 months I was on my back for.
I'm actually I can't explain. I mean, you know me a long time, and you know how I think, and we talk like this a lot.
Yeah.
So I'm just filtering through everything, every conversation we've had, and you know what I'm doing right now. Sorry, folks, this really doesn't belong on radio yet.
No, it doesn't. Yeah. Buddy, go on, throw a tune on and let's say goodnight. I think we've done a fabulous job, Dave. We really have taken the subject exactly where we said that we were going to. I think we've assembled it within a meaningful framework that everybody can take something away and actually add something meaningful to at least the way that they view the information that they receive.
Well, here's what I'm going to say. That was clearly, I now understand why you were as nervous as you were coming on. And as I say, it's an absolute damn shame we didn't have our last conversation recorded, because we were going through a lot of this stuff, folks. And I mean, I was actually attempting to say to everybody tonight, if you will, look, I hate to use the expression, dumb it down a little, but because it's insulting. But to be honest, I need that dumbed down a little for me, Jack, just so I can then expand on it again, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I'm more than happily...
I don't mean dumbed down in the negative sense.
What this could probably do with, realistically, is kind of a longer time frame being allowed for individual sections so that they can actually be sort of taken apart more. But as a general covering of the subject, I think we've done an admirable job tonight, and I'm really very happy with the amount of information that we've been able to condense into what's been a technically difficult show of a shorter time than we were expecting, because of the necessity of bringing Billy on air for his important information, all the router problems. I've had the fire alarm going off here, you've had the dogs barking, the connection's dropping, you know what I mean? Admirable. With a little bit of editing, we're going to have a piece here that will stand alone and will be a treatise to the subjects that we've covered.
Well, I'd like to say I think that tonight is a very significant and important start. I'm going to call it a start. I mean, it's not starting in my head. I'm zooming ahead in the future here. I'm doing all sorts of things here in my skull as we talk. I actually need to sit down somewhere quietly for about an hour or two and just kind of go, right?
Yeah.
Right. Because I've got a billion questions for you. I really do. Of course, the guys in the chat box there saying Jack needs a show. Jack used to be on here, folks, and we'll be back
on it in the next few weeks. Let me just restore my health a little bit so that I can actually commit to something and know that I'm going to be able to carry it through and hopefully raise my financial status a little, so probably I can afford a slightly better internet connection than the crappy cheapo one that I'm apparently to. Those two provisos, I'll be back on it as soon as possible with a regular spot covering all of these issues and more. I don't want to do it flaky. I need to do it professionally, and I need to do it confidently, because my nerves are tattered and I'm not going back to the nervous breakdown that numerical flux drove me to, which is the one that drove me off air last time.
You're not allowed, okay? Vin is not letting you.
Numerical flux during the week and come on air and do 3 hours in front of a cold mic is killing me.
You're not allowed, okay? I'm not letting you have a breakdown, okay?
Yeah, no. I wouldn't allow myself to go there now. I would simply just come on air and just, you know, I mean, explain that, you know, I mean, that week I've been too busy and you're getting a pod, folks. Suck out.
Okay, I'm going to finish with Book Rogers from Feeder. Ihawagas Kolosov, I will be back before Christmas. Yes, I will, the 20th. And then I'll be 2 days after. So, yeah, I will see you next week, folks. I'll try and line up a something a little special for you next week. Jack, I can't say thank you enough, man. It would not be adequate. It would not be adequate. So
I'm going to have a shower now. I'm all soggy.
Yeah, just you. Yeah, I just need time to just go and sit in the corner somewhere and just rock forward.
mop your fetid books.
Well, I need to go and rock back and forward for an hour or two, okay?
Go home for a bit.
Good night, folks.
All right, well, I'm going to drop the call and I'm going to let you say you can, like, so I can jump in the chat and at least show me face, because I haven't even looked in the chat. I think I put two sentences.
Go on. Hang up. Cheers, Jack.